Shabbat Shalom. We are playing musical chairs this morning, and I won. it's so wonderful to be sitting here and sharing this beautiful morning with you. Today we're going to be looking at the story of the three women of the Purim story. Now, this came up for me in part based on some of the conversations that have been happening at home. Every day I'm reading the paper about the war in Ukraine, and every day I'm like, this has to stop. We have to do more. We have to stand up. The American government has to do more. And every day, Solomon says to me, but if the American government does more, it could create World War III. It could create nuclear threats to more innocent people. It could be even more damaging. We have this ongoing back and forth and back and forth. And so looking at the Purim story is also a story of impending destruction. Here it's not war that's already started, but it's certainly a tyrannical leader who's already taken over 127 provinces. It's a story of a leader who leads with drunkenness and debauchery, and who willy-nilly is willing to destroy part of his community just because someone asked. So we'll look at three women in his life, three women and how they face that destruction, and see if their responses have something to teach us. So we'll start together with the blessing for the Torah.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kirishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu la'asok b'divrei Torah. V'ha'arev na Adonai Eloheinu et divrei Torah v'finu v'fi amcha b'it Yisrael, v'niye anachnu v'tzatzainu v'tzatzai amcha b'it Yisrael, kulanu yodei shemecha v'lomgei Torah tachalishma. Baruch atah Adonai hamelamed Torah le'amo Yisrael. Baruch ata Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher bachavanu mikol ha'amim, v'natamanu et Torato. Baruch ata Adonai, notein ha'Torah.
Amen. So we'll start at the beginning of the Megillah. We're beginning with Vashti. And Vashti is just demonized by the rabbinic tradition. And we'll just look in for why a little bit. This starts... King Ahasuerus has thrown 180 days of partying, and now he's done another seven. And he gets it in his mind to bring his wife Vashti. So Lord Nessun, hoping you will do me the honor of reading in the bold on the first page, where it says...
Bayom Hashvi'i?
Yes.
Okay. In English?
Yes, please.
Oh, okay.
Spanish, if you want.
I was practicing chanting. Okay. On the seventh day, when the king was merry with wine, came to speak, he ordered Mehuman, Bisita, Chargona, Bika, Abakukha, Zatar and Karkas, the seven eunuchs and attendants on King Ahasuerosh, to bring Queen Vashti before the king wearing a royal diadem to display her beauty to the people, the peoples and the officials, for she was a beautiful woman. But Queen Vashti refused to come at the king's command conveyed by the eunuchs.
The king is furious. How dare she defy my order? Why won't she come? He asks his advisors what he should do. Dan, would you continue on the next page, verse 19?
Verse 19.
It's like six lines from the
bottom. Yes, okay. If it please your majesty, let a royal edict be issued to you, and let it be written into the laws of Persia and Media, so that it cannot be abrogated, that Vashti shall never enter the presence of the king Ahasuerus. And let your majesty bestow her royal state upon another who is more worthy than she.
Great. Thank you so much. So the king agrees. It's a great idea. Lest any woman think that she can stand up to any man, all men should rule without question. So I wanted to ask everyone first to go back into what's going on for Vashti. What's going through Vashti's mind when she gets this request through all these advisors? What is she thinking?
Well, can I back up a second?
Yes.
I would like to ask you, the way you framed this in the teaser was you asserted two things that I'm sure there's drash for, there's a midrash, at least I saw for one of them. One is that Ahasuerus summoned her to be nude, okay? Which it doesn't say. It says that he had her to bring Queen Vashti before the king wearing a royal diadem to display her beauty to the peoples and the officials, for she was a beautiful woman. But nowhere does it say nude. There is a midrash that you do cite later on in your very generous package that says...
You're welcome.
Yes. That when the king says, bring a royal crown... he means only a royal crown, so that's where the nude thing comes from. And then the second thing that you asserted in your framing in that teaser was that she's executed, that she dies, right? She doesn't come and she's dead. And it doesn't say that. The text says that she shall never enter the presence of the king again, so that she's going to be for the pshat seems to be that she's formerly the queen, that she's disregarded. And my question to you is why, and it's International Women's Month, and my question to you, and you were positing these as stories that could tell us something about the human condition and the human condition for women today. And my question was to ask you, why go to the more extreme of he wants her nude when the regular is pretty bad enough? And why go to the extreme of he wants her dead when the regular he wants her disregarded is enough? What inspired you to frame it that way?
So I think the nudity feels to me shot. Like, why would you say what she's wearing if you're not, if like, there's no reason otherwise? Why would he ask her to come in a royal crown? Like, she's royalty. She could wear that whenever she wants, A. B, to never appear before the king? Like, how do you ensure that other than death? So those two things, to me, I also just think he's a pig, and that reinforces right. that story.
Yeah, although, you know, certainly if you have seen or heard the musical Six, you know that banishment is likewise a pretty terrible punishment for a woman of that time.
Yeah. But just one last thing, and then I'll stop. It feels to me like what's the offense of this husband to this wife? It was to treat her, it was to not respect her, to not see her, to not lovingly communicate with her. Like, you would think that if this were a healthy marriage, he would say to her, oh, hon, by the way, I have a big event at the palace tonight. Could you come by about 6 o'clock? There's some people I'd like you to meet. Or let's say he forgot to do it in the morning when they got up. He sends her a text, whatever that would look like, in the ancient world. Hey, hon, I forgot to tell you. I'm so sorry. I just had a lot on my mind, but in 3 hours, I'm going to have, like, a delegation. Could you come by, right? And instead, he doesn't talk to her at all. He gets these 7 eunuchs. And then the Hebrew is lahavi at vashti hamakar lifnei hamelach, to bring vashti. Because she's an object. She's a piece of meat. She's an object. And it feels like the pshat feels much scarier to me for women than the, right? Like, that's very scary. And my question to you is, what's the resonance of that as well?
Why does that feel more scary?
Just because it's more common that the people in a relationship don't see each other. It's like I, it versus I, thou. And I, you know, I'm gonna just get 7 eunuchs to communicate with you, to bring you like your package, yeah. Lahavi advice. Yeah.
To me, we'll talk more about this later. But to me, Haman has a much healthier relationship with his wife.
Yeah. They're on the same page.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Than Ahasuerus. And to be honest with you, I mean, I'm sorry. I know it's Women's Day, and I don't like any of the men here, but I feel really sorry. The people who I feel really sorry here are the eunuchs. Poor people. Oh, my God. Can you imagine going through that? Poor people. Eunuchs. Those are the martyrs of this story.
I'm with you.
All right. So I'm just going to add a challenge to the only, and it's the rabbinic take that, you know, only the royal diadem, only the Keter HaMalchut, and because in this generous package,
I couldn't think, there were so many texts.
When we look, although it's not paginated, so nope. I can't
tell you. Still learning.
It does say, V'yisam Keter HaMalchut Barasha, when speaking of Esther, that Esther put the royal, it's the exact same language used for Vashti, and Esther doesn't. When Esther does it, the rabbis get so excited. They love that Esther does it. Mm-hmm. And when Vashti does it, they literally turn her into a demon. I mean, they give her a tail. You know, Vashti is clearly the villain of the story. And, you know, one of the big reasons is this one I can say on page 3. Says, you know, and that way all wives will treat their husbands with respect. And there is this sense that, you know, Vashti saying no to the king is so transgressive. This idea that a woman could have an opinion to herself and an idea of what she wanted and not just what he wanted. And I agree with you, Wes, but that in and of itself is problem enough right. and challenge enough. And I just want to note that it's so interesting to me that the rabbis are just so savage with her, because the word that's used when she refuses, the tima'en, is actually exactly the word that is used for Yosef. For Yosef, when Joseph Hatzadik, and he gets called Yosef Hatzadik because he refuses immorality, and she gets just absolutely eviscerated.
So can you just say a word about this? I don't know, this feels maybe like it's 1970s Judaism, but I'll move it to 2022. How do you as women rabbis engage a patriarchal Talmudic tradition where they're just horrible? Like, we like to say that the foundation of Judaism is the Talmud, but then you read the Talmud on Vashti and they're horrible. What do you do with patriarchal pigs?
Okay, can I say something?
No, just answer that question.
No. I want to clarify something.
Yeah.
She is leading the class today.
Okay.
So she is doing the questions. You be the motor to that chair.
Okay.
You know, for 2 years I've been having neck problems sitting in that chair looking like this all the time.
It's impossible.
You've been demoted.
Okay.
She does the questions today.
Okay.
Alisa,
okay.
Please, go ahead.
I'm happy to answer that. I think it feels like, I mean, so I'm really grateful you pointed that out, because that feels like, one of the things I wanted to talk about was that there is this trope, right? The first woman who gets this treatment is Lilith, and her first sin is she says no to Adam, and she gets expelled from the garden. She gets demonized. Like, even in Talmud, it says, don't fall asleep in a room alone lest Lilith come and get you. And she's just this demon. Women who say no become demons. And that's certainly something that we see in our world today, which is any time, there in the restaurant industry, there are a lot of cases where male managers could say, like, what are you doing? Go back and do the dishes. And people would do it. And if a woman manager said, like, what are you doing? Go back and do the dishes. You'd be like, oh, geez, what a four-letter, five-letter word, blah, 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 blah. How dare she? Why is she saying that? And so,
I also think that there's a piece here that runs, you've got to look deeper, because you asked the question about how do I think about rabbinic literature? How do we think about rabbinic literature given this really misogynistic trope that's running through here? In some ways, the very story of the Megillah itself is redemptive, because ultimately, although Esther is the person, who says yes to Uncle Mordechai, she's certainly not saying yes to the plan of Ahasuerus, her husband, which has been egged on by Haman. And therefore, in some way, when Esther gets the opportunity to say, no, I'm not going to stand for this, I'm going to be an actor in history, she becomes kind of the Eve to the Lilith. She becomes the sort of moving forward of the story. We start the story in not a great place with women, and over time, I think we do get a little bit better and better. I mean, the two of us are sitting here today.
Yeah. You go from all the way back then to all the way today. Yes.
I want to go back to, Wes, your initial analysis of the relationship. So, I mean, if you think about what the role of a queen was, back in, 2,000 years ago, whatever it was, she was part of a harem. Vashti was part of a harem. And so there's no, it's all about sex and not about relationships. So I think there could be no such thing as a loving relationship in terms of the king and his harem of women. So that's one thing I want to say. I want to bring up another little story. When my very first poem here in the Gan Chapel, with the chapel, I'm reading. Yes,
it was at the time of
Ahasuerus. Yes, I was.
There was another millennium.
So, I start to chant the Megillah, and I get to the word Vashti, and I hear a little in the background, and I turn around, and there's one of our members who had a dog. She brought the dog to the Megillah reading. Now the dog's name was Vashti. And why did you name her Vashti? He says, because I call her and she never comes. Okay. True story. It's a true story. Okay.
So I want to call this back, and I want to pull this back and look at if Vashti is responding to, and here's my premise, Ahasuerus is a pig. He's a jerk. He, gives these parties. His one command is that people just drink as much as possible. He has no respect for women. If her strategy is to oppose him, is it a good strategy? What is her strategy? Is it worthwhile? Is it something we should be thinking about today? Are there ever times for the strategy of Vashti, which is a just hard no?
Well, it's interesting what you were saying, Michelle, comparing the trajectory of Hadassah, I mean, Esther. And one of the things that the story begins, correct me if I'm wrong, but the story with her begins that the king brings a new set of women to spend the night with him, and Esther is one of them. So in a way, she's following men's rules and all the, you know, seeing women as meat and all that stuff. So it's fascinating. But then she ends up being who she is.
I mean, I think one of the core and critical differences here is that we don't have a sense of larger purpose for Vashti. I mean, today as a woman, I would say, you know, you go, girl, right? And I'm all for standing up for individual right to be able to articulate your own mind and do what you believe is the right thing, particularly in a space of debauchery, right? To be able to say no is one of the critical things that we believe today. But it is not necessarily for a global and larger purpose. Whereas I think when you're thinking about Esther, right? Esther's actions are taken, even in a sense, she's not ready. She doesn't know how. She's not exactly enthusiastic about doing it, but it's for a larger purpose. And it feels to me like when we act for a larger purpose, that can give us more strength, more meaning, and I think more effectiveness.
Which is so interesting to me because in the text itself, actually, it gives Vashti a larger purpose, that her defiance actually gives women around the country, around the empire, the space to say no. And so in essence, like the text gives her a larger purpose.
Or the text is saying, oh no, the husband, you know, the wives will look at this and they'll get out of hand, right? It's not that she's acting. It doesn't say, you know, Vashti has developed a feminist campaign and she's saying, come with me, sisters, say no to your husbands, right? It's not that. She's acting and they're worried that somebody's going to see what she does and then act in that way, which I think is different from what Esther does, which is she's intentionally acting on behalf of her people.
But I'm not sure this text knows about feminist campaigns. Wes, I saw you wanted to jump in.
So how does it feel to be in that chair?
Yeah, it feels awesome. You know, you asked a question about strategy, Aliza. I think one of the deeper resonances of the Vashti piece for today is about structural inequality and institutional forces that transcend any individual's agency. I mean, if you're born... And, you know, so much of our life is zip code. It's when we're born and where we're born and the circumstances in which we're born. And you could be a person of incredible talent and strength and resource, you know, resolve and all this good stuff. But if you're born in a really challenged zip code, really bad time, really bad place, I mean, you began by talking about the war in Ukraine and the conversations you and Solomon have. Think about these kids. I was watching the news this morning who are getting hypothermia. They just had the misfortune of being born in Ukraine now, and they're just on the road. There's 2.5 million refugees. And to me, the Vashti question is what happens when it's actually not even about strategy? It's about structural inequality or institutional inequality or factors that just exceed and dwarf the importance of your humanity. The kids walking around in Ukraine today, they could be the fastest and the strongest. They could jump high. They could be brilliant. They could be Einstein. They could be Mozart. They could be Shakespeare. But they're just refugees who are freezing and starving. And so their agency is superseded by the weight of their circumstance. And I feel like that's kind of, in Vashti and the whole biblical world, what happens when strategy is irrelevant? Because no matter how strong their strategy is, the circumstances are stronger.
Beautiful. So we're going
to
keep...
Next time I will vote for you to be back in this room.
All right, we're going to keep going with Zeresh. It's in the middle of the packet.
I just hope Levine is not watching.
What page?
There's no page. Still learning about this chair. There's a lot that goes on in this chair. It's in the middle of the packet. Esther chapter 5. Just go with me. Here we go. So Zeresh appears twice in the Megillah. Both times
She appears after a decision has already been made, after action has already been initiated, and she always appears with a gaggle of other people. So there are two sort of situations. The first day, Haman is just furious that Mordecai won't bow down to him. He's plotting his destruction. And he goes home. We're chapter 5, verse 10. And he sent for his friends and his wife Zeresh, and Haman told them about his great wealth and his many sons, and all about how the king had promoted him and advanced him above the officials and the king's courtiers. What is more, said Haman, Queen Esther gave a feast, and besides the king, she did not have anyone but me. And tomorrow, too, I am invited by her along with the king. Yet all this means nothing to me every time I see that Jew Mordecai sitting at the palace gate. Then his wife Zeresh and all his friends said to him, let a stake be put up 50 cubits high, and in the morning ask the king to have Mordecai impaled on it. Then you can go gaily with the king to the feast. The proposal pleased Haman, and he had the stake put up. Now fast forward.
Can I just take issue with your translation for 1 minute?
It's Safaria's translation.
Yes, so Safaria has a very, Safari. I mean, I'd be really interested for those of you who are mavens on translations here, but, you know, V'yitlu.
Namely none of us.
V'yitlu, right, it feels like you're hanging, and it's an eighth gavoha, and that sounds gallows, not impalement, so maybe there's torture device that I'm not entirely cognizant on.
For our purposes of this class, like, she just, like, let him be killed. Like,
yeah, let him be killed.
I think for her, totally hear you, and we're going to keep going. Not going to get derailed. So then.
But can I just actually.
No.
Okay.
I just want to get these two things in, and then you guys can all talk about it.
Okay.
So the next thing that happens after after the king wakes up in the middle of the night, he realizes Mordecai saved his life. He says to Haman, what should I do to honor this great man? Haman gives him this whole thing, and Ahasuerus says, great, do that for Mordecai. Haman is totally upset. He comes home. We're in a chapter 6, verse 13. There Haman told his wife Zeresh and all his friends everything that had befallen him. His advisors and his wife Zeresh said to him, if Mordecai, before whom you have begun to fall, is of Jewish stock, you will not overcome him. You will fall before him to your ruin. Okay. How do we understand Zeresh in these moments? Feel free.
Okay.
So
can I say something quick?
You can be
please.
Hung and impaled. We'll agree. So
more of what I said before, comparing Vashti with Zeresh. To me, this speaks to me like a much more current, marriage relationship, where normally I come home and I said, Lorena, guess what? Something happened to me. I don't know what to do. I mean, tell me. And she was like, go and disturb. No. she's very sweet. But, you know, this is much more seriously talking. This is a much more healthier relationship when you are confident with your wife and you come and you tell about your issues and, in a way, are asking her to give her your opinion and pointing you in a certain direction. So I like this a lot, and I actually, now that I read this, I would have been much scarier of her than to Haman.
Well, so that's what I want to pick up, because in your teaser, you laid out that Zeresh goes along to get along. And, like, the pshat, the actual plain meaning of the text here, Haman comes home, and he's, oi, darling, I don't know what to do. My heart is so heavy.
Honey,
I don't know what to do. My heart is so heavy. I'm hurting. I'm just so upset. And she says, you know, build the gallows or the impalement.
A whole group
okay,
of people.
Wait, but the first time she comes up, it's her first and then the group of people behind her. She actually is the instigator. She is Haman 1.0, and he goes out in the world and acts as Haman 2.0, carrying out actually the decisions that she, as the woman behind him, is having him go do.
But this is something I haven't understood, because before that even happens, Haman is the one who sets out. He's already issued the law, the decree to destroy the Jews. Like, it's not like that isn't already in process. So part of my read of her is that she's responding to her husband. Her husband has issued this law.
So, okay, yeah. So Michelle, so you had asked earlier about the Hebrew and Ha'ais, etc. No. I think it's a really important question because actually, I have something to say here. And this is a lot of the meaning of Megillat Esther is hidden in this fact. Okay? It's the difference between hanging and impaling. And sorry about this, people, but I have to go here. Hanging is, you know what hanging is. Impaling is different, and impaling is, and if you Google impaling, it's taking a stake and sticking it through a person's genitals till it comes out of their mouth. So it's extremely graphic. It's extreme cruelty. It's extreme cruelty. And the Torah, the Torah basically says people have to be buried, even their biggest enemy has to be buried on the day of, and impaling is just considered extreme torture and beyond horribleness, right? And it turns out Zeresh suggests not just that Mordechai be killed, but that he be impaled. So Zeresh is, I agree with you, Michelle, not going along to getting along. She's instigating not just cruelty, she's instigating exceptional cruelty. Right. And as you know, in Megillat Esther, everything is inverted. It's a lev hafuch. And in the end, Zeresh's idea that will take Mordechai and impale him, right? The Jews in chapter 9 do that to Haman and his kids. After they're hanged, then they're impaled. Right. So you have extreme cruelty run amok. So, to me, in terms of the wife-husband dynamic, what happens when a spouse brings out the worst in their spouse?
Right, and exactly. And I agree with you. And sorry, but you get the message now that being in the church means you've been attacked.
Like
you know, the person who sits there gets attacked. No, but in the way you're, sorry about this. No, but in the teaser, the way you're portraying her is like in a way like she knows that her husband is evil, and she's afraid of him, and she needs to go along with him. And to me, you know, there is a reason she perhaps married him. Because in a way, she was exactly like him, or even worse. So to me, it's not a lot of the time she says, I woke up and, oh, who is this monster that is married with me? Actually, no. She's actually fulfilling something that is inside her as well.
I think there's also, when we don't know the kinds of compromises that she made in her marriage in order to stay with him this long, right? And so we're reading her only in this moment, and we're not seeing the story of their whole marriage. I think it's entirely possible that, like, he operates the way that everybody else in this time operates, and this is how she's found a way to be useful to him and found a way to be seen by him. And it's not pretty, but I think it's important, the order of how things happen.
What were you hoping for us to bring out in terms of a model of response from her?
So she doesn't really, I mean, you all see her much more actively than I see her in terms of that she is instigated, that she is actually making things happen. And so that's just sort of a different response.
I wanted to just dwell on one other thing in the source that you give. Her last, Zeresh's last words are now that Haman realizes that Mordechai has the upper hand, she says, and this is her last verse, if Mordechai, before whom you have begun to fall, is of Jewish stock, you will not overcome him. You will fall before him to your ruin. The end. Okay? Now, to me, that's also very, so, like, I guess we shouldn't be surprised. No heart, no consolation, no compassion, no love, no honey. But instead, she's like extreme cruelty, and now she's kind of extreme sober sobriety. Your demise is coming. And I'm wondering, what do we learn from that kind of posture? What's the Zeresh? I presume it's to avoid something, but is it to do something? Like, what does Zeresh teach women on International Women's Month?
Ben, can you talk a little bit? Because you've been very quiet. And as a moderator of the room, I think we need to.
Maybe she's suggesting being preemptive. Like, in other words, if you don't do what I just suggested, which is to, you know, hang and then impale, then, and, and and so allow, if you don't, if you allow Mordecai, aka all of the Jews, to continue to survive, then you will have this terrible downfall. Maybe that's what she's suggesting. Right. I mean, you know, we read the Megillah. Obviously, it's there's so many layers to it. It's, you know, it's a farce. It's mythological, but there's also, you know, but it's all, there's also an embedded story, right, about the rise, about the decline of one sort of thing and the rise of another. In terms of what we're talking about, you know, the general theme about the women, and we mentioned hafuch, the inversion, right? So we have Vashti, who's demonized, and then the inversion where the whole story is really about women. The whole story is about women. The whole focus of it. It's, you know, first is Vashti, and then it's Esther, and then it's Zeresh, and Esther again. So it's all about inversions where women start off completely at the lowest possible point, and then become in a sense the heroines or the heroes of the story.
Yeah, I actually, thank you, Dan. But I actually want to go back, Wes, to what you said about the people who bring out the best in us and the people who bring out the worst in us. And I think, as we're looking at the world, I think it's really important that Zeresh always appears with the rabble, right, with all those friends, because Zeresh is that kind of that worst voice inside of us that's often kind of, well, everybody is saying this, right? And it's very easy to look at the world that way and fall under that sway, and it's really hard to step back and say, wait, well, who am I here? What do I really think is the right thing?
With that, let's keep going to Esther. It's on a page.
Learning so many things today, let me tell you. There's a chapter too. It's on page Esther chapter 4, but it's really not on the page where the title is. It's on the next page.
When Mordecai finds out about Haman's decree to destroy the Jewish population, he's very upset, and he puts on sackcloth, and he goes around the city just crying out. And Esther's first move is very interesting. Her first move is to send him, like, different clothes, to, like, change your clothes, get out of those sackcloths. Like, you can't be seen around here wearing those sackcloths. He refuses. Instead, he sends back a copy of the law, the decree of the destruction of the Jews, and a request that she would go and beg King Ahasuerus. And so we'll pick up on a page where it says, I'll read it because I'm here. verse 9. When Hatach came and delivered Mordecai's message to Esther, Esther told Hatach to take back to Mordecai the following reply. All the king's courtiers and the people of the king's provinces know that if any person, man or woman, enters the king's presence in the inner court without having been summoned, there is but one law for him, that he should be put to death. Only if the king extends the golden scepter to him may he live. Now I have not been summoned to visit the king for the last 30 days. When Mordecai was told what Esther had said, Mordecai had this message delivered to Esther. Do not imagine that you, of all the Jews, will escape with your life by being in the king's palace. On the contrary, if you keep silent in this crisis, relief and deliverance will come to the Jews from another quarter, while you and your father's house will perish. And who knows, perhaps you have attained royal position for just such a crisis. Then Esther sent back this answer to Mordecai. Go, assemble all the Jews who live in Shushan and fast in my behalf. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maidens will observe the same fast. Then I shall go to the king, though it is contrary to the law. And if I am to perish, I shall perish. So they all fast. She goes to the king. He inclines his scepter. And she asks for the favor of getting to throw a party. She throws a party, it's a great party, and then she asks for the favor of another party, and then at that second party, she does the big reveal, and the king is very, very generous. He's like, up to half the kingdom, I'll give it to you. And she says to him, if your majesty, I'm in Esther chapter 7, if your majesty will do me the favor, and if it pleases your majesty, let my life be granted me as my wish, and my people as my request. For we have been sold, my people and I, to be destroyed, massacred, and exterminated. Had we only been sold as bondmen and bondwomen, I would have kept silent, for the adversary is not worthy of the king's trouble. Thereupon King Ahasuerus demanded of King Esther, of Queen Esther, who is he and where is he who dared to do this? The adversary and the enemy, replied Esther, is this evil Haman. And Haman cringed in terror before the king and queen. So
the first thing that comes up in my mind is the way you started today, describing Ahasuerus, saying that he was a drunk, that he was a dictatorship and all that stuff, and then that treated women very badly, but he's completely different in this chapter, in the way he reacts to her. So is it possible that all human beings is not something new, but we all have like multitude of personalities among ourselves? What do you think?
I mean, I think also Ahasuerus goes through his own process of realization. My favorite moment in the Megillah, I shouldn't say my favorite, but one of my favorite moments is in the beginning of chapter 2 when he realizes what he has had done to Vashti. And he's just filled with remorse and regret, and you can hear it in the music. And when Esther comes along, we don't get any reason for why they fall in love, or at least he loves her. She doesn't wear any makeup. She doesn't do any of the things that the other women do. But he just loves her above and beyond everyone else. And it's an interesting, I have this question of whether he loves her extra, he sees her extra because of his mistakes with Vashti.
Yeah, so you framed this class of the three women, Vashti, Zeresh, and Esther, in this week and month of International Women's Month. We're thinking about that, and what light they shed. And so Vashti is problematic because her strategy is not as strong as the circumstance. And Zeresh is problematic because she seems to be pure evil. Like, she's the one that comes up with the idea of impaling and egging on. Esther is the woman in the story that feels very rich to me, because Esther means hidden. And one of the sources that you brought in your rich collection mentions a source that her, she's beautiful but hidden. She's Hadassah, she's beautiful, but Esther's hidden. And I wanted to talk about, what does it say about, like, do women have to hide certain parts? So she hides her Judaism, her Jewish identity. That's the big hidden fact. But is this making a point about women having to hide essential parts of their personality to make it in a man's world? Is that one of the themes? She has to hide her Jewish identity, but since you're bringing it in the month of International Women's Month, what light does that shed on the issue and the theme of hiddenness?
The other thing, I want to just talk to that quickly. I'm thinking about what other things are hidden. Like, Esther has so much EQ. I mean, she really understands Ahasuerus, that he's really not all that smart, that he's very easily manipulated, and that she throws a party because she knows he loves parties, he has another party because he knows those parties, and then uses that leverage of understanding how much he likes to drink, and also how easily flying off the handle he is, so that she uses that leverage, that EQ, and also that really high intelligence to be able to move the story forward and be able to, you know, to rescue the Jewish people and herself specifically.
You can see it in another way. That's a very good perspective, but Alisa's perspective is more like they fall in love with each other.
Mm-hmm.
And in a way, you can also see as Esther not trying to hurt her husband by, you know, how to manage and being afraid that he's going to like me even if I tell him that I'm Jewish.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it can be seen as both ways.
Well, the Midrash also, in the Talmud, talks about Hadassah, that she was actually green, and I love this story. That she, her essential nature was such that her whole experience of life was hiding. And I don't know, you know, it's an interesting love story. I think he definitely loves her. It's hard to know how she seems too smart to love him. And, right, like, she doesn't.
Also,
what happens in life. Women
also
are smarter than men.
Where there's such a power imbalance, how could there be love? I mean, don't you need to have co-equal power for love? Right.
And I was also going to pick up on the love thing, because it feels to me like when he hears from Esther that she and her people are going to be destroyed and killed, you know, v'hamelech kam b'chamato, right? He's angry about that. He's upset about that. But when he sees Haman lying on the couch, he says, do you mean to ravish my wife here? It feels like it's a lot about sex. It's a lot about lust. It's a lot about power. It's a lot about, you know, that's my wife. And I'm not sure how much of it is about, you know, I'm so deeply devoted to Esther.
Right, and in that way, it feels like also his response, his, you know, she sets up a situation in which Haman is behaves inappropriately towards her, and that actually grants the freedom, not her, you know, it, maybe that's her strategy, is to actually set him up to be in an unfortunate situation, mm-hmm. knowing that he's going to be drunk, knowing that he's going to be out of control. But it's very interesting, and even I find so interesting about Esther, her first move when she finds out about this decree is like, Mordecai, put on different clothes, like, stop mourning, stop being publicly upset about this, what are you doing? Mm-hmm. And the text gives Mordecai this, like, you know, empowering line, like, you've got to be the person, rise up, you've got this, you're going to save us all. But it's
so complicated. Could you speak to the word that you used at the beginning, which is strategy? To what extent is hiddenness a strategy? And a wise strategy for Esther and for women today?
I think it's potentially a really wise strategy. I think that, you know, in part, Esther lives out the truth, give people what they want until they want what you want to give. That she's like a chameleon. She makes herself. And I think as we're trying to figure out how to solve the challenges of our world, there's a lot of hidden motives, a lot of hidden strategy that's being employed. I don't know if that's so effective right now, but
well, I mean, I can speak. I speak a little bit for you know what my wife talks to me about the corporate world in terms of you know biotechs and stuff like that. You said it a little bit before when a CEO of a company screams, everybody says amen. They say, oh my God, what a leadership, and he's great. And when a woman does the same, the hormones must be kicking in, you know, and she's out of control. She cannot lead it. So it's completely unfair. And in a way, answering your question, what is the only way that she can be successful there? By hiding the emotions, in a way, that she's under control and stuff like that. So it's completely unfair. And it shouldn't be like that. But yeah. It's what happens these days.
But her strength ultimately is not in her hiddenness. Her strength is when she's able to give up her strategy of hiddenness and realizing that she has to reveal herself in order to be able to accomplish any sort of tikkun olam, any sort of positive movement in her world. And she realizes that actually maybe what Mordecai says to her is true. She does find herself in a place where she has a voice. She may not know how to use it, but she has to figure that out. And I think that's not just important for women. I think that's important for all of us as humans, that there are times where we want to hide. We don't want to step up to the moment. And it's actually in finding that voice, that power, that opportunity in that place where you can act.
Can you get a read on Esther's attitude towards her own Judaism? Is she enthusiastic about it? Is she ambivalent about it? Is it kind of imposed upon her, like, oh, okay, I got to do this? Like, if you know, or is she like, wow, I get to save my people? What does she think about the Jewish people? What's her attitude?
Well, I'm not sure that that's I mean, I know this is a Jewish text, but I'm not even sure that that's the most important point about the Megillah. I think that, in a sense, her kind of, we could look at it as a story of, you know, I have finally returned. I am a balat tshuva, right? Yeah. I'm like totally with my people now, right? And that's beautiful and lovely and I think an important read. But within the context that you set up here today, Elisa, I think that the more sort of universal message speaks to us as Jews, not about how she feels about her Judaism, but about how we feel about our Judaism leading us to step up, to speak out, to act up. And she is the example of that. And when we find ourselves not knowing what to do, to continue to ask ourselves the question, maybe I'm brought to this moment.
Right, but I can just make a case why her inner voice matters. Because if she's ambivalent about her Jewish identity, you know, Elisa, you mentioned twice, her almost embarrassment at Mordecai, my Nujnik uncle, my Nujnik uncle, the Jew, you're kind of embarrassing me. And if she has that kind of feeling, and yet she does what she does, I think that's in a way a more powerful statement. that somebody who is kind of ambivalent rises to the moment and saves her people. That just feels to me like a different, in other words, like it's one thing when a rabbi does something Jewish, because they're a rabbi, you're expecting them to do it. But if you're, let's say you come with, you're much more secular, you're much more disconnected, you're right, and but something moves you, that feels like a more powerful and accessible message, and it feels like that's what's going on with Esther.
I was going to say also that, you know, you notice that when Esther is actually begging the king to save, she's not saying save the Jew, my people, the Jews. She says, my people. She doesn't actually specify, whereas Zeresh is very clear to specify the Jews. So maybe there, I don't know if it's an ambivalence or the fact that she's using that, the sense of, you know, I'm going to get killed, me and my people, but it's me that's going to get killed without actually referencing the greater community.
Yeah, and it goes back to what you said earlier before, the fact that you were born in a certain zip code, you know, defines in a way who you are. There are so many times, and this is what I experienced in my life, that I have to hide the fact that I was a Jew in order to survive in a way. And that doesn't make me less of a Jew, actually, because I didn't show it proudly in the outside world. It's just the circumstance that it surrounded me. One thing I want to say before we end is congratulations on this class. You selected very thought-provoking. Excellent leadership. He's going to get back to that chair next week. I'm the tall and the mass bike, so the Zelser stays here in the middle while you go from one chair to the other, but kol hakavod.
Thank you. I also just want to say with this whole text, you know, I think Mordecai also has a complicated Jewish identity. He marries off his niece to a non-Jew. Like, he puts her in a situation where she is exposed and endangered, and even when we think we have pure intentions and clarity of purpose, we often get confounded. And so as we're looking at these stories of these three women in the Megillah, my prayer is that we'll be able to see all of them for the fullness of who they are, and that when we are encountering injustice in our world, when we're encountering the realities of our world, we'll be able to muster the right response that will enable us to achieve a better world.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Thank you.